Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, Alhamdulillahi, and Alhamdulillahi nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruhu wa na'udhu billahi min shururi anfusina wa min sayyiati a'malina wa ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lahu wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluhu salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi amma ba'du fa inna khayr al-kalami kalamullahi wa khayr al-huda huda rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa sharu al-umur muhtathatuha wa kulla muhtathatin bid'atun wa kulla bid'atin dalala wa kulla dalalatin finnari. Inshallah Azawajal, in this session, ikhwani, I want to deal with another important issue and concept and observation that the ulama of al-Islam have made in regard to the many different sects and the many different jama'at that we find present from amongst the Muslims from yesterday, in the past, historically, as well as today. And again, the goal and the objective is not to take cheap shots and to talk bad about people and to make my group, my idea, my fikr up and put everybody down. It's not the goal and the objective. The goal and the objective is that Allah Azza wa Jalla in many ayats of the Quran has challenged the intellect of the Muslims by asking the people, would they not make a tadabbur? Afala yatadabburuna al-Quran? Do they not concentrate and contemplate and consider the Quran? He mentions those ayahs, afala ta'qilun, don't you people use your aql? Don't you use your mind? So there are certain observations that are clear that, inshallah azza wa jal, we want to take one of them to show you how the way of the companions is without fault. And the way of all the other groups, they have fault. It doesn't mean that those other groups are 100% no good, because no one is 100% no good. Shaytan, la'natullah alayhi, he taught Abu Huraira, Ayatul Kursi was the greatest ayat of the Quran. A shaytan, he used to say, Allah is my Lord. On the day of Badr, when he was making the non-Muslims want to fight the Muslims, he said, I see what you see, you don't see. Inni ara ma la taroon. Inni akhafullah. I see what you don't see. I'm getting out of here. And he left them in their time of need. He was making waswas. Let's go fight. Making waswas. So they went to fight. When the fight was about to happen, Shaitan saw Jibril and the Malaika, and he saw all of that, and he said, you people in trouble. He said, I'm getting out of here. And he went the other way, and he left them. So those words of Shaitan are the haq. No one is 100% wrong. The clock that doesn't work is stuck on 1 o'clock. It's correct 2 times every day. Every day. So it is not acceptable for someone to go overboard, especially if you're a parent, if you're a teacher, if you're a husband, you're a wife, and you always say to your child, you are no good. You never do anything. You are no good. Because no one is like that. Even the non-Muslims, you can't think of them like that, as you're going to see, inshallah. So the point is, the other groups that are not on the exact way of the companions, radiallahu anhum, they're going to bring to the table a tanakkus. There are going to be deficiencies in their issues. Now, the point that I want to make today is we're going to talk about some of the tashabuh, the wujuh of a tashabuh, some of the many similarities that exist between all of the groups, without any exception, how they resemble the Jews and what they believe and in what they do. All of the groups have some resemblance to the Yahud and to the Christians, but especially the Yahud. Because I just want to take one group today, but each and every group from the Jama'at, that you know the names of them, I mentioned their names, they have this issue. The groups of the Madhahib. There's nothing wrong with having a Madhahib as a systematic way to get from one point to the next point. You want to get fiqh in your religion, so you want to be Hanafi. Imam Abu Hanifa was a great scholar in Islam. He was an ayah from the ayat of Allah Azza wa Jalla. So if I want to take and learn about fiqh from the Hanafi Madhab, there's nothing wrong with that. Some great scholars from that Madhab. The problem is when Al-Imam Abu Hanifa made a mistake in his madhab, you have to do like his students did, Muhammad ibn Hassan al-Shaybani. You have to do what Abu Yusuf did. And that was when they saw the Imam took the wrong position, they went against a third of the madhab. They didn't say the Imam must have known and made excuses. So the people who do the madhabs the wrong way, like it used to be in Mecca, the Hanafis would pray behind one Imam, Salat al-Dhuhr. And then the Shafi'i would pray behind another man, Salat al-Dhuhr. And then the Malikis would pray behind a third Imam, Salat al-Dhuhr. And then the Hanbalis would pray behind a fourth Imam, Salat al-Dhuhr. So every prayer was three or four jama'at. So those people who follow the madahib this way, with a ta'assub, they have a similarity to the Yahud. Al-Ikhwan Muslimin, Jama'at al-Tabligh, the Turuq al-Sufiya, Hizb al-Tahrir, all of these groups, they resemble the Jews in different aspects. But there's one group that I want to focus on today because of the danger that they pose to this ummah. They never meant good for al-Islam. From the time of the Khulafa al-Rashidin till today, they never meant good. The fitna in Syria, they have a lot to do with that fitna and the killing of the innocent people, because they're the ones who are supplying weapons and military might and ability to the Syrian regime. That's a disbelieving regime. And that is the Rafida, the Ithna Ashariya, the 12 Imamas of Al-Iraq and Al-Iran and Pakistan and Lebanon and Afghanistan and Algeria, as well as Bangladesh. Now, I know our Pakistani brothers, our Afghani brothers, people, they don't curse the companions. They're against people who curse the companions. But we have relatives. We have relatives who they curse the companions. We have relatives. In al-Islam, you have to take a position towards people. And I say we should deal with everybody in a nice way. That's how the Prophet was, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He dealt with people in a nice way. But there are certain things that people do, certain things that people say, there's no room for dealing with them in a nice way. Hikmah necessitates that you have to deal with them tough and rough. The Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he overlooked what Quraysh did to him and his companions when they kicked him out of Mecca and made him migrate to Al-Medina, and they confiscated the property of the Muslims and the money of the Muslims. They persecuted and killed the Muslims. They said nasty things. They did bad things. They fought against the Muslims, killed some of the companions. When the Prophet went back to Medina, to Mecca, and he conquered Mecca in the year of Fath Mecca, he forgave all of them, and he didn't get revenge. He said, anyone who goes to the house of Abu Sufyan, you're free. Anyone who goes outside of the precincts of Mecca, the outskirts, you're free. We won't do anything to you. Anyone who makes it to the Kaaba, you're free. You're protected. He told his companions, but four people, if you catch these four holding on to the curtain of the Kaaba, I want you to kill these four. And they were four people from the Mushrikun who used to write poetry, and they used to describe his wives. They didn't know anything about his wives, but they were being filthy, and they were being nasty and lewd. So the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he took revenge against those four, because what they said was OTT. It was over the top. It was too much. He didn't forgive them. So the Rafida, it's not permissible for you to marry your daughter into that family because they're your cousins or your aunt. It's not permissible for you to marry your son into that family. But instead, you have to give them dawah, ilallah. If those people don't embrace the dawah, that you can't say what they say about the companions and the things that they believe, you have to say at some point, lakum dinukum waliyadin. At some point, you have to say that to them. So the Rafida, they have a lot of characteristics that are similar to the Yahud. A lot. I'm only going to mention maybe four today, only four. And there are many, many, many more. Each one of the characteristics that I'm going to mention, each one is enough to be destroyed by. The Yahud were destroyed because of these issues. And again, I want to repeat, this is not something that is peculiar only to the Rafida. The Ikhwan Muslimin, they share in some of these issues. Jama'at al-Tabligh, they share in some of these issues. The people who follow the Turuq al-Sufiyya, they share in some of these issues. And that's because, as we mentioned, all of these groups should be abandoned, and the Muslims have a responsibility to just try to replicate, inshallah, to the best of our ability, the aqidah, the minhaj, and the ibadat of those companions, radiyallahu anhum ajma'in. We already mentioned some already in that hadith. The Jews broke up into 71 sects and the Christians broke up into 72 sects. So from the characteristics of Ahlul Kitab is at-tafarruq wa ikhtilaf. The tafarruq and the ikhtilaf that, as we mentioned, leads to argumentation and hatred. That's what's not permissible. The ikhtilaf that when the truth comes, you still are taking a position against the truth. That's what's not permissible. As for you understood the issue one way and I understood it another way, and you have dalil and I have dalil, and both of the dalil is muhtamil, nothing's wrong with that. Allah mentioned in the Quran, وَلَوْ شَاءَ رَبُّكَ لَجَعَلَ النَّاسَ أُمَّةً وَاحِدًا وَلَا يَزَالُونَ مُخْتَلِفِينَ إِلَّا مَنْ رَحِمَ رَبُّكَ لِذَلِكَ خَلَقَهُمْ. If Allah wanted, He could have made all of the people one ummah, one religion. Everybody could have been on Tawheed and Islam. Everybody, Allah said, but they will not cease to have ikhtilaf between themselves except the people that Allah has rahmah for. And for this reason, they were created. Allah created them to have ikhtilaf. I'm going to have ikhtilaf with every one of you if we traveled from here to Montreal in a car and we started talking about the deen or the dunya. I'm going to agree with some things with you and I'm going to disagree. You're going to agree with some things with me and you're going to disagree. And there's room for that. But the ikhtilaf that's not permissible is, I want to fight you. You want to fight me? I hate you. You hate me. And this is what we have with these jama'at. So this has already been issued. It dealt with. Al-ikhtilaf and al-tafarruq. It's from the way of the Yahud and the Nasara. Leave that on the side. There are some real serious characteristics. First one that we want to mention, ikhwani, is al-ghulu. Al-ghulu in the salihin, or in the people who they believe are salihin. Going overboard in the righteous people. That is a characteristic of the Yahud and the Nasara. And that is a characteristic of all of the people of the Jama'at, all of them. The person is a Ikhwan Muslimin. Whenever he mentions Sayyid Qutb, he says a Shaheed. If you mention that he is a Shaheed, then he is automatically in Jannah. And if you tell the man, don't say Shaheed, that's not correct, he'll get mad at you. He'll say, you want to be ruled by secularism. No, don't say Shaheed. You put him in Jannah when you say that. Al-Imam Abu Hanifa, the person says, Al-Imam Abu Hanifa is Al-Imam Al-A'zam. He's the greatest Imam. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prayed with the prophets and the messengers in Bayt al-Maqdis and the Isra wal-Mi'raj. Rasulullah is Al-Imam Al-A'zam. So people go overboard. They have ghulu. They have ghulu in Al-Albani. Ghulu in whoever the sheikh is. Our Jama'at is the Jama'at. What my Imam said. And that's one of the characteristics, the filthy characteristics of the Yahud. Allah Ta'ala mentioned in the Quran about them, اتخذوا أحبارهم ورهبانهم أرباب من دون الله وما أمروا إلا ليعبدوا إله واحدا. They took their monks and their priests as lords along with Allah. And they were commanded to worship Allah alone, the Yahud and the Nasara. One of the Arabs who became a Muslim, his name is Hatim al-Ta'i. He came and he listened to the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as a Christian. He had a cross on his neck. Prophet Muhammad was giving him dawah. When he heard this ayat, he said, we didn't worship them. We didn't make sajda to them. We didn't worship them. The Prophet said, when they made halal haram and haram halal, did you obey them? He said, yes. He said, that was your ibadah. Only Allah can legislate. أَمْ لَهُمْ شُرَكَى شَرْعُ لَهُمْ مِنَ الدِّينِ مَا لَمْ يَأْذِنْ بِهِ اللَّهِ. Legislation only for Allah. So the person is with his group, his jama'at, and it's clear what they're doing, it's clear what they're saying is haram, but because it's in the dastur of the jama'at, the people, they go with it as if it's okay. Allah mentioned about the Yahud and the Nasara. وَقَالَتِ الْيَهُودُ عُزَيْرِ بْنُ اللَّهِ وَقَالَتِ النَّصَارَ الْمَسِيحُ بْنُ اللَّهِ ذَلِكَ قَوْلُهُمْ بِأَفْوَاهِهِمْ يُضَاهِئُونَ قَوْلَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا مِنْ قَبْلِ قَاتَلَهُمُ اللَّهُ أَنَّا يُؤْفَكُونَ. The Jews said that Uzair is the son of Allah. The Christians said that the Messiah, Isa ibn Maryam, is the son of Allah. That is the statement that they make with their own tongues, and they are being similar to those people who disbelieved before them. May Allah destroy them for what they're making up. Going overboard. in the righteous people. Allah Azza wa Jalla mentioned as well other ayat, but the time doesn't allow. But in terms of the hadith, haddith wala haraj, the Prophet, he told the people, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, la'an Allah al-Yahud wal-Nasara ittakhadhu qabura anbiya'ihim masajid. May Allah curse the Jews and the Christians. They made the qabr of their prophets places to worship. He, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when the Muslims used to go, some would go overboard. Some of the companions, the way of the companions is correct. Some of them made mistakes, but the Prophet rectified it. They say, ya Sayyidina, wabna Sayyidina, you're our master and the son of our master. You're the great one, you're this, you're that. The Prophet would tell them, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, la tatruni kama atartan nasara Isa ibn Maryam. إنما أنا عبد الله ورسوله. Don't go overboard with me the way the Nasara went overboard with Isa ibn Maryam. I'm Abdullah and I am Rasulullah. I am Abdullah and I am Rasulullah. In Sahih al-Bukhari, Akhwani, there's a very important hadith where the Nabi said, لو آمن إثنى عشر من اليهود لآمنت اليهود. If there were 12 Jews who believed in me, then all of the Jews would have believed in me, all of them. Now we know there are more than 12 Jews who are from the companions. More than 12 Jews believed. The Prophet said if 12 of them believed, then all of the Jews would have believed. What's the meaning of the hadith? Is there a contradiction? If you go to those books that gather the names of the companions, Usud al-Ghaba, Al-Isaba fi Tamyiz al-Sahaba, all of those books that give us the names of the companions, and there are way more than 12 Jews. Is that hadith inside al-Bukhari, something's wrong with it? There are more than 12. But scholars said the meaning of the hadith is that the Prophet was saying, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if 12 of the ulama of the Jews of Al-Medina believed in him, then they would have followed their ulama because they go overboard in their ulama. That's one of the characteristics of the Yahud. They have the Torah today, right now. The average Jew, the practicing religious Jew, he doesn't read the Torah. He reads the Talmud. The Talmud is the tafsir of the Torah by the ulama. And they believe that the kalam of the ulama of the Talmud is better, more comprehensive than the kalam of the Torah because they have al-ghulu in the Salihin. Al-ghulu, they go overboard. Ya'qub in the Bible. Ya'qub in the Old Testament. He challenged Allah in the Old Testament. Challenged Allah. And Allah Ta'ala, he challenged Allah to a wrestling match. Allah made a human being. He came down in the form of a human being. The time was up until Fajr. The book said they started wrestling and Fajr was about to come up. Allah was on the ground in the form of that man and said, hey, Fajr is almost here. Let me up. Ya'qub said, I won't let you up until you give me some special things. And then Allah gave him some special things. Like his name was Ya'qub, but at that point he was called Israel, Bani Israel. That's how he got that name, because it means the one who was powerful and overpowered the people. So the man who was in the form of Allah said, you overpowered Allah, you overpowered the people, so you're Israel. That's Bible right now at this moment. So it's ghulu is a mushkila. Shirk came into this existence because of this ghulu, going overboard. As for the Rafida, they have this ghulu. They say that Ali ibn Abi Talib is Allah reincarnated. During the time of Ali radiallahu anhu, some people came and a man said, Anta huwa, you were him. Ali said, I'm who? He said, you Allah, that there's no God worthy of worship except you. Ali told the people who was the Khalifa, he said, dig a hole. They dug a hole, he made a big fire and threw him in the hole. Threw him in the fire and burnt him. Another man came and said, Wallahi, I have no doubt you're Allah, because only Allah punishes with the fire. Ghulu. The ghulu in Hassan, the ghulu in Hussein, the ghulu in Fatima, going overboard. Now, as I mentioned, Ikhwani, this is not something that is peculiar to the Rafida. This is peculiar to the people of the Jama'at, having ghulu in their ulama. And now as people of the Sunnah, I say to you young brothers who are trying to practice as-Salafiyah, don't have ghulu in the ulama who we respect. Al-Albani does not deserve to have that ghulu in him. Whatever he says is correct.
Ibn Baz, whatever he says is correct. Ibn Uthaymeen, whatever he says is correct. Sometimes now the dalil has become the sheikh said. If someone said to you, where's the dalil? He said, the sheikh said. That's not a dalil. Don't have ghulu in Sheikh Rabir. Anything Sheikh Rabir says, if you don't take it, some people in this city will throw you off of the sunnah simply because you said, I don't believe that the sheikh is correct in this issue. They will even test you and come and say, what do you think about Sheikh Rabir? And if you don't say he's from the major scholars, you get thrown off of the sunnah. That's ghulu, ghulu. Another example, Ikhwani, is the opposite of that. The Rafidah, like Bani Israel, when they have ghulu on one hand towards their Salihin, they have ghulu on the other hand against people who they hate. So the Yahud, they go overboard in people who they hate. They put down the people who they hate. They make a ta'an in the people who they hate. I told you the story yesterday in the Bible right now. What did the Yahud say? The Yahud said that Nuh drank khamar and he became drunk. They said that Lot, in the Bible right now. When Allah told him to leave his city, he left his city with his two daughters and his wife. His wife turned around and she was turned into stone. They were not supposed to turn around. Don't turn around. She turned around, she was turned into stone. No doubt in the Quran, in the Islamic narrative, her wife, his wife, made khiyana, and she's in the hellfire, in the Quran. Was it because she turned around and turned? We don't know about all that. But she made khiyana. The Bible says that they walked, and when they arrived at their place, the two daughters said, hey, our father, he doesn't have any more people. He doesn't have any more people. So let's give him some khamar and make him drunk, and let's make zina with our father. So they did that 2 days in a row. With the Nabi of Islam. So those negativities and those statements, they are consistent throughout the Bible with those people. They rejected Isa ibn Maryam. They said that his mother was a zaniya. They rejected him, said his mother was a zaniya. They rejected Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam time and time again. And they knew he came with the signs that their prophets told them. The Nabi, who is the Khatam of the Anbiya and the Rasul, is going to have this characteristic. You can ask him these questions. You can ask him this, ask him that. Don't follow a fake Messiah, a fake prophet. He's going to be able to tell you certain things. And that's what Allah said in the Quran, يَعْرِفُونَهُ كَمَا يَعْرِفُونَ أَبْنَاءُهُمْ. They knew the prophet the same way they knew their very sons. Those of you who have children, you knew your child before your child even came into existence, meaning you knew he was in his mother's stomach. You knew when he had bad days, good days. When he came out, he doesn't even know about himself. You know he was a colic baby. You know what type of challenges he had in terms of medical issues and so forth and so on. They knew that the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam was Rasulullah. They knew that. And yet they said those nasty things. Their prophets told them, when this prophet come, ask him three questions. If he can answer them, he is a prophet. First question, ask him, what will be the first food of the people of Al-Jannah? Number two, what makes the child resemble the mother or the father? Or what makes the child a male or a female? Ask him. Third question, who brings the revelation, the wahi? They say, we want to ask you three questions. He said, tafaddal, ask. They asked the first one, what's the first food of people of Jannah? He said, it's going to be the liver of a particular fish. They said, okay, that's correct. What makes the child resemble the man or the woman, or makes it a girl, a male or a female? The prophet told them the right answer. They said, okay, last question, who brings down the revelation? He said, Jibril. They said, oh, if you would have said Mikael, we would have accepted it. Jibril is our enemy. Jibril brings to us war and pestilence and problems. And Allah Ta'ala mentioned that ayah in the Quran about whoever is an enemy to Jibril. فَإِنُّهُ نَزَّلَهُ عَلَىٰ قَلْبِكَ بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ مُصَدِّقًا لِمَا بَيْنِ يَدَيْهِ وَهُدًى وَبُشْرَىٰ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ مَنْ كَانَ عَدُوًا لِلَّهِ وَمَلَائِكَتِي وَرُسُلِي وَجِبْرِيلَ وَمِكَالَ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ عَدُوٌّ لِلْكَافِرِينَ. So they have that pattern of talking bad about the righteous people. The Rafida, same thing. The Rafida, Ikhwani, talk bad about the Prophet first and foremost, and what they say and what they accuse. When they say that the companions apostated, they're talking against the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Here I'm an individual, I come to this place. I don't know most of you, but I have good opinions about you. If I don't know who's around me, who I marry my daughter to, if I don't know that, then there's a problem. I'm marrying into a criminal family. I'm doing this. It shows that I'm jahil. I'm ahmaq. The Nabi was intelligent. He knew who was around him. He knew the munafiqeen. He knew the munafiqeen. He told Hudhayfa the names of all of the munafiqeen. And you're telling me that he didn't know his companions were kuffar? So when you say that Abu Bakr and Umar were homosexuals, that's what they said about Abu Bakr and Umar. They said that Aisha committed zina. All of the companions apostated except three. Who didn't apostate? Al-Miqdad ibn al-Aswad. Salman al-Farisi, because he's from Persia. Abu Dharr, he didn't apostate. Everybody else apostated. The companions, they stole. The Nabi said, As-sariqatu finnar. Stealing is in the hellfire. It's a major sin. You get your hand chopped off. They said that the companions came together and they stole the khilafah from Ali ibn Abi Talib. Now, this is not peculiar to the Rafida. All of the other groups have this stuff as well. If you're not from their group, they will be against you. They will be against you. I told you, Al-Albani is the muhaddith of this time. Not the only one. Before Al-Albani, the ulama who used to take care of the hadith were the ulama in India and Pakistan. Before Al-Albani, Shamsul Haq, Al-Abadi, those ulama over there. And then Al-Albani came and he surpassed everyone. But it was the ulama of Al-Hadith from Al-Hadith in Pakistan, in India, in that area. In that area. When Al-Albani came, the Ummah should have appreciated him. When he was in Al-Sham, the Ikhwan Muslimin used to warn against Al-Albani and tell the people, don't go and learn from him. When the man was just trying to tell the people, hey, look, look, I'm trying to help you to clean up your concept of Al-Islam. This book, Fiqh Sunnah by Sayyid Sabiq, Rahimullah, it is a good book of comparative fiqh. It's one of the most important books that's studied in the Muslim world right now, today. What did Al-Albani do? If he had a ta'asab and asabi and hizbiyah, he would have warned against the book. Instead of warning against that book that was written by a knowledgeable person from the Ikhwan Muslimin, he went into that book and he showed the hadith that were authentic and not authentic so that people can benefit. And they used to warn against him. And that's how it is. That's how it is. You're a person who calls to Tawheed, Brelwis, Deobandis, they were warned. Sufis, you don't love Rasulullah. You're the Wahhabi. You're this, you're that. Muhammad Abdul Wahhab is hated by people of Sufiya. And what did he do? All he did, he doesn't deserve to be worshipped. All he used to do was, those Arabs in Arabia during his time, those Arabs were worshipping rocks and trees. If you made Hajj and you came from Africa, you made Hajj and you came from Africa, they will put you in slavery, them Arabs during that time. They were messed up. He came and he gave his people Tawheed. Does that mean everything about Saudi Arabia is correct? Everything that he did is correct? Doesn't mean that. The point is, hatred for the opponent, hatred for the one you perceive as being the enemy. Don't go overboard. The companions were in the middle. They were in the middle. They were in the middle in their love and their hate. They didn't have that type of ghulu. Another characteristic, Ikhwani, is the characteristic of al-ihtiqar and looking down upon people, despising other people. The Jews have that characteristic throughout the Quran. They have that. Allah mentioned it in many ayat. Al-ihtiqar. Seeing themselves as being what they call the Sha'bullah al-Mukhtar. They see themselves as being the people of Allah. Now, just imagine for a moment, because sometimes I don't think, Ikhwani, we really look at the Palestinian issue with the precision or the natural eye look, the natural way of looking at something. Some of you have properties where you come from. Your father's house, he got it from his father, he got it from his grandfather. Every time another son comes, he expands it, or maybe it stayed the same. It's your property. Someone comes to you and says, he's not from your religion, he's not from your people. He comes and says, that's my house. You say, why? Why is that your house? What's the delil? God made it my house. And you're supposed to just walk and say, okay, you have the house? They came and took the land of the Palestinians. And their argument in the whole dunya is, God promised us that. That's the promised land. And they look down on other people. The Rafida had that same problem. Allah mentioned in exposing this characteristic in the Yahud in a number of ayat. وَقَالَتِ الْيَهُودُ وَالنَّصَارَى نَحْنُ أَبْنَاءُ اللَّهِ وَأَحِبَّاؤُهُ قُلْ فَلِمَا يُعَذِّبُكُمْ بِذَنُوبِكُمْ بَلْ أَنْتُمْ بَشَرٌ مِّمَّنْ خَلَقَ. يا يَغْفِرُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ وَيُعَذِّبُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ. The Jews and the Christians, they say, we are the sons of Allah, and we are the ones who Allah loves. He loves us, and we're his sons. And not you people, not you Muslims or anybody else. Allah said to Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, tell them, Ya Muhammad, if you're the sons of Allah and the beloved of Allah, why does he punish you for your sins and your crimes? Allah forgives whoever he wants to forgive, and he punishes whoever he wants to punish. To him belongs the dominion of the heavens and the earth. Another ayat. قَالُوا لَن تَمَسَّنَ النَّارُ إِلَّا أَيَّامٍ مَعْدُودًا قُلْ أَتَّخَذْتُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَهْدًا أَمْ تَقُولُونَ عَلَى اللَّهِ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. They said, we, the Jews, we're not going to go to the hellfire except for a few days. We're only going to go. If we do go, we'll go for the amount of time that Musa was up on the mountain and we took the idol. We made the calf as the idol. But we're not going to go. But if we do go, we'll go for a few number of days. Allah said, tell them, Ya Muhammad, did you take a contract from Allah in that regard? Or are you saying about Allah what you don't know? Characteristic of the Yahud, speaking about Allah without knowledge. You don't have to be from the Rafidah to have that characteristic. The Prophet said this, and you use a weak hadith. The Prophet did that, and you say a weak hadith. Allah said this, said that, and you're not saying the right thing. It's from the characteristics of the Yahud. Allah mentioned, showing how they look down at other people. Look down. وَمِنْ أَهْلِ الْكِتَابِ مَنْهُ بِقِنْتَارٍ يُؤَدِّهِ إِلَيْكِ وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ إِنْ تَأْمَنْهُ بِدِنَارٍ لَا يُؤَدِّهِ إِلَيْكَ إِلَّا مَا دُمْتَ عَلَيْهِ قَائِمًا ذَلِكَ بِأَنَّهُمْ قَالُوا لَيْسَ عَلَيْنَا فِي الْأُمِّيِّينَ سَبِيلٌ يَقُولُونَ عَلَى اللَّهِ الْكَذِبَ وَهُمْ يَعْلَمُونَ. Allah said, from the Jews, from Ahlul Kitab, or some people, if you give them a whole big treasure, as in a man, and you say, take care of this treasure, from them are those people who will give it back to you when you come for it, which goes to show the justice of Islam. Some Jews are decent people. Some Christians are decent people. Some kuffar are decent people. Don't be of those people who say all of them are not good, because Allah said, innama al-mushrikuna najis. They have najasa. Najis here means shirk. Najis here means in their clothes. After they relieve themselves, they don't wash correctly. And even that, not all of them have that. There are some Arabs who are Christians and Jews, they make istinja. So the ayah said that from Ahlul Kitab, those people, if you give them a whole treasure as an amana, he'll give it back to you. And from them are some, if you give them one dinar, you give them $1, you give them £1, £1, £1, he won't give it to you unless you stood over him and you demanded it. And that's because they say, we don't have any responsibility to the non-Jews. We don't have any responsibility to the non-Jews. In that Bible right now. In the law of eating, in that Bible right now, where it talks about the dietary law, it tells the people, the Gentiles, who are the non-Jews, you can sell the Gentile the food that is no good, a dead animal, but you can't eat it, but you can sell it to the Gentile. You can sell it to the Gentile because the Gentiles, non-Jewish people, the Gentiles, they are dirty. They're not going to Jannah and so forth. So then they have the nerve when people say what Allah said about them in the Quran, about the maskh, with them becoming monkeys and swine, and that has its meaning. They come and say, you people are racist. You people are teaching hatred towards. La. In their book, they have that stuff. What are you talking about? They teach that stuff. Why don't you jump up and down with what they're doing in Palestine? What are you talking about? So there are many other examples, ikhwani, but we just want to show the issue of the Rafidah. The Rafidah, they believe in their books, like the book Al-Kafi to Al-Kulini. Al-Kulini, Al-Kafi is one of their most important scholars, Al-Kulini. He said that the souls of the Rafidah, before they came into existence, they were created from the izzah of the light of Allah for every Rafida Shiite. That Allah is angry with all of the other people except the people who are the Rafida. That's why they used to call that guy Ruhullah Khomeini. Ruhullah, he was the spirit of Allah, meaning his soul is from the izzah of Allah Ta'ala and the azimah of Allah Azza wa Jalla. And if you were to gather up what they believe and what they teach about themselves and others, it is nasty. You know this thing about tuqya? Tuqya is when you lie. Tuqya is when you lie. It is one of the fundamental pillars of the Ithna Ashariya. Khomeini said, anyone who doesn't have tuqya, he doesn't have a deen. But tuqya with who? Tuqya with who? Tuqya with Ahl Sunnah, people not Shiite. They will lie to you. And that's why when the Ikhwan Muslimin, Ikhwani, and I don't mean this to like take cheap shots. It's just to show the Ikhwan Muslimin, they have some good with them, no doubt about it. They have some decent people, that people have knowledge, that people are sincere, people have ibadah, ulama of the Quran, but their minhaj is decrepit. It's not what we should be upon. They used to call the Muslim empire, the Muslims, to have becoming brothers with the Shiite in the Iranian revolution in 79. How? These people will tell you when you say, do you curse the companions? He's going to say, no, wallahi. And his religion allows him to do that. To who? Not to the other Shiite, but to the Ahl Sunnah. You can never believe him. How many of you heard a man by the name of a Sheikh Anan Ar-Or? That Sheikh Anan Ar-Or, he has a clip on the internet, YouTube, where he's debating with a Shiite scholar. And he's talking about how another Shiite scholar said bad things about Aisha. Bad things about Aisha. So he said, what's your opinion about that? He said that to the Shiite man. The Shiite man made tuqya. He was calm and he said, nah, you know, we shouldn't say these things. I say to my brothers from the Shiite, you should not say this. This is not nice. He was very calm. You shouldn't, because he was making tuqya. He was just saying that. So the Sheikh Anan Ar-Or wanted to show the people, look, this man is making tuqya. He said, okay, you people do muta marriage, right? You see muta marriage, right? He said, yes. He said, okay, the Mahdi that you believe in, not the real Mahdi, your Mahdi, is it permissible for his wife to do muta? The man went off. He jumped up. Billah, why you say that? And he really went crazy. The Sheikh Anan said, hey, I'm not saying that she does muta. I'm trying to make a point. When it came to the wife of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you didn't get excited. It was no problem. But when we talk about the wife of your Mahdi, now you have al-asabiyah. Now you have al-hirs. Now you have ghira. It's like some of the people, unfortunately, ikhwani, with al-imam Abu Hanifa. The scholars of al-hadith and hadith graded Abu Hanifa as da'if in hadith. That doesn't take away from Abu Hanifa. He is an imam of the dunya. But in hadith, his narrations are da'if. In aqidah, he said this thing of the murji'a. He is from the fuqaha and murji'a. They're the least less of the murji'a. That's what the ulama said. If you say that to someone who is muta'asib on the Hanafi madhab, he'll get upset. He'll go crazy. Where is that anger for your relatives from the Rafidah? Where is that anger for the people who talk bad about the Prophet's wives, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the companions? So the point is here, the Yahud, they have an ihtiqar, and they look down on people who are not Yahud, and they have that double standard with the non-Yahudi. The Muslim has to be fair and just with everybody. He has to be a shaheed. We have to be shuhada against ourselves, against our parents, against our relatives, from the haq that has to be said and from the justice of Islam for those who don't know. Because one brother came to me yesterday, he was asking me about Syria. He wants to go to Syria and he wants to protect the Muslims from getting raped and he wanted to know what's my opinion. I said, stay here, man, and be a good student in your school. Go to the university, take care of your mother and your father. Build your life. That makes more sense. What are you going to do over there? Those people don't need anybody over there. They need our money. They need our dua. And what you're asking is, hey, Sabesa, take it easy. For those who don't know, the foreign policy of America, the foreign policy of the UK, the foreign policy of Canada and so forth that we don't agree with, and you have a right not to agree with it, although we don't agree with that foreign policy of Canada, you are not going to find a more hospitable country to accommodate you than Canada. Some of you may sit there and take that word and say, wala wal bara, that's hubb al-kuffar. No, that's the justice of Islam. That statement doesn't mean that they love us. Allah said in the Quran, وَلَن تَرْضَ عَنْكَ الْيَهُودُ وَالنَّصَارَى حَتَّى تَتَّبِعَ مِلَّتَهُمْ. That's clear ayah. The point is, why would you people, you youngsters, why would you destroy the peace and the tranquility that you're living in right now? I went to Norway a few months ago. Norway has consistently, for the last 20 years, been graded as one of the best places that you can live in Europe. The standard of living, the quality of living. I went there to give the khutbah in a Somali masjid and to give a seminar for some youngsters, about 50 of them, 60 of them. When question and answer time came, all of the questions were going to Syria. We got to go to Syria. The Norwegians are this, Norwegians are that. And now they're creating problems for themselves. Pretty soon that Norwegian government is going to come and shut them down. They're going to shut them down. So we have to be people who are balanced, not like the Yahud, not like the Rafida, not like these other groups. Jamaat al-Tabligh. When I used to go to Jamaat al-Tabligh when I first became a Muslim, the people I was a Muslim with, African Americans, they were the Nation of Islam. Then they became real Muslims, but ignorant. They didn't have knowledge. They didn't have knowledge. When I was with those guys, I could see, man, these guys are really twisted and mixed up. I met some brothers from Jamaat al-Tabligh, and they were seemingly paying attention to the sunnah and things like that. I said, this is what I want to do. So I went with them, but then I began to see some things with them. They were asking me to get up and talk. I'm a brand spanking new Muslim. What I'm going to say? They said, it's going to come to you. Don't worry about it. So I learned the 7 points. From the 7 points, ikram and Muslim. Ikramul Muslim. Ikramul Muslim with Jamaat al-Tabligh, what does it mean? Is ikram of the Muslims from Jamaat al-Tabligh. Because if you are not from Jamaat al-Tabligh and you start challenging some of that stuff, the history, the aqidah, the minhaj, the statements, why aren't we combining our prayers and we're travelers? Why aren't we shortening our prayers and we're travelers? What is this hadith? And this book is filled with khurafat and mawdu'at and kadhib on the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What is this Sufism and this shirk that's in the origin of how this Jama'at came about? Now you become an enemy. What happened to Ikram al-Muslim? Ikram al-Muslim if you Jama'at al-Tabligh. So the point is, not all of them are like that. Not all of them are like that. I'm just saying, the way of the companions, you didn't find it at all. That is the correct way. More things can be said about that, Khwani, but we want to move on. You know, I'm choosing the Rafida again because I don't want you people to be sleeping about a reality. Some people are really agitated and excited about Syria, and rightly so. You have to know that the role that Iran plays in that fitna is significant. It is a significant role. In Yemen, there is a place called Damaj. People from all around the world, youngsters, they go to Damaj for free. And you can learn the Quran, the Sunnah, and the Minhaj al-Salafi. There's a sheikh there, his name is Yahya al-Hujuri. He is not perfect. He is not bigger than Sheikh Muqbil. He is not mistakeless. But nonetheless, you can go there and you can learn your religion. Memorize the Quran. Get an understanding. And you don't have to pay anything. They're a group of Rafida. They're called the Houthiyun. For the last 2.5 months, 3 months now, they have enclosed that area and they're killing those Muslims. Because the Rafida never want and never brought to the table good for the Muslims. Lebanon, they never brought any good to the Muslims. Never. So when we don't know our Aqidah, that guy, Hassan Nasrullah, the leader of the group called Hezbollah. Why is it called Hezbollah? You people think they just called it Hezbollah? It's because they believe. They are the real party of Allah. They are created, their souls, from the ruh of the izzah of Allah. I saw that man 3-4 years ago when he had that problem with Israel and he started saying, we're going to do this and we're going to do this to Israel. You find the Muslim who's supposed to love the companion say, ah, mashallah, he's the mujahid. This is jihad. This is it. In 1979, in the Iranian war, a lot of African-American Muslims became Muslims. You know why? Because when Iran took over, those students took over the American embassy in Tehran, The first thing they did, it was on the news, and then this government here and the news agencies locked it down. First thing they did, all of the black Marines that were inside of the embassy, they said, you all are free. Your people are oppressed in America. You can go. When that happened, it was dawah. A lot of black people in America became Muslims. They said, what is this religion? There was a man during the time of the companions, during the time of the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he was making jihad and he was real good. And the people came and said, Ya Rasulullah, that man is good. He did this, do that. The Prophet said, he's from the people of the hellfire. They said, what? He's from the people of the hellfire. Next day, they engaged the enemy. Someone stabbed him. He had a wound and it was hurting. So he took his knife, he put it in the ground, and he threw himself on the knife and he committed suicide. The companions saw it. The Prophet said it. They saw it. They went and they told him what happened. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, inna allaha layansur hadhaddeen birrajul fajir. It's possible for Allah to help this religion with an evil man. They let those black Marines go. Black Americans came into Islam. Okay, akhi, why are you a Muslim? I'm a Muslim because the Iranians, they did this, they did that. La. That's a Machiavellian concept. Machiavelli, he was a Jew who came up with these concepts, principles, political principles, like the enemy of my enemy is my friend. Hassan Nasrallah is the enemy of my enemy, Israel. So therefore, he's my friend. That's not our religion. We have al-wala wal-bara, my daughter, my son, my mother, my father. If they are on the other side of the truth, I have to take a position. That's why Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr as-Siddiq, on the day of Badr, he said to his father, I could have killed you, Abu Bakr, I could have killed you. You had your back to me many times, but when I saw it was you, I went somewhere else. Abu Bakr said, had the tables been turned and I could have killed you, I would have killed you. I would have dealt with you. But the boy ultimately became a Muslim and he became from the ulama of the Muslims. Last point that we want to make, inshallah, Azza wa Jal, Khwani, is the Jews in the Islamic narrative of the Quran and the Sunnah, they made tahrif of the Quran. They made tahrif of the books of Allah. They changed the books that were revealed to them. They make tahrif. Allah Ta'ala mentioned, مِنَ الَّذِينَ هَادُوا يُحَرِّفُونَ الْكَلِمَ عَنْ مَوَادِعِهِ. From those people who were Jews, they changed the words from their right place. From the right place. يَا أَهْلَ الْكِتَابِ لِمَا تَلْبِسُونَ الْحَقَّ بِالْبَاطِلِ وَتَكْتُمُوا الْحَقَّ وَأَنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ. أَهْلُ الْكِتَابِ, why do you people shroud and cover up the haqq with falsehood? And you hide the truth and you know. They used to do this consistently during the time of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Tahrif of the book, it can come in different ways where you change the book. What you can do is you can actually change the meaning of what's being said. The hand of Allah, someone says it's the ni'mah of Allah. Allah comes down, it means that Allah's rahmah comes down. That's tahrif. That's one way. Tahrif also means you can change a word, take one word out and put another word in. The Yahud used to do that. The ayat of stoning was in there. So they wanted to get a ruling and they went to the Nabi and they said, hey, can you judge for our case? The Nabi said, okay. Someone committed zina and they were married. The Prophet said, isn't that in your book? They said, no. So he told his companion who learned their language, Zayd ibn Thabit, hey, open the book. So they were with the Jewish leader. He was reading. He put his thumb, his fingers over the line where it's rajam, tried to hide it. Prophet Muhammad said, hey, pick your hand up, man. Pick your hand up. And there was the ayat. The ayat was there. They used to change the words. Allah told them, Qulu hittatun. Say hitta, which means astaghfirullah. Instead of say hitta, they say hanta. Hanta. They changed the word. It means like barley. The Rafidah, they do the same thing, ikhwan. They said in the Quran, Inna Allaha ya'murukum in tadhbahu al-baqara, Allah commands you to kill a cow, slaughter a cow, Surah al-Baqara. Their interpretation is, the cow is Aisha. Allah commands you to slaughter Aisha. They made tahrif. They said that this Quran that we have right here is one third, that there are two other Qurans. It should be two. If you get two more like this, the real Quran is that big. But the companions took it away and put it out. And they have the other two. They have the other two. And the other two is filled with khurafat, lies. All it's talking about is the wilaya of Ali. Ali is the wali. Ali is the wali. That's it. The ayah, inna aratna al-amana ala al-samawati wal-ardi wal-jibal fa'abayna yahminnaha wa shfaqna minha wa hamila al-insan innuhu kana zuluman juhula. Allah offered the amana of spreading the dawah, la ilaha illallah, upon the heavens and the earth and the mountains, and they were afraid to take responsibility of it, and they refused to do it. But mankind took the responsibility of it, and he was oppressed and he was ignorant. They said that this ayah is that the heavens and the earth and the mountains and everything, it didn't want to take responsibility for recognizing that Ali was the one. Everything is about Ali, 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 Ali. Ali, Ali, Ali. And there's just too many examples of this with them. But as I mentioned, and I close with this, as I mentioned, this is not something that's specific and peculiar to the Rafida. All of the jama'at have that. Tahrif, the Jahmiyyah, the Mu'tazila, the Asha'ira, all of the people in Aqidah, they're making things mean what Allah didn't want it to mean. So what we have to do again is we don't find that with the companions. We don't find them making any tahrif of the Quran, the Sunnah. We don't find them following their desires, anything like that. So with that being the case, ikhwani, alayna inshallah bi tariqat as-salaf. We're going to stop right here inshallah. And for this session, they said we have a few minutes for Q&A. So if you brothers have any questions about my topic today, you can ask your question inshallah. Tafadhal ya akhi. Hey little man, come here for a minute please. Can you tell the brother just to warm that up for me? Please put a little bit more like tea, make it strong, some tea and honey there. Go ahead, akhi. Where are you from? Concerning the question the brother wants to know about the Zaydiya of Al-Yemen. They're from the Shiite. Are they like the Rafida? La kalla. The Zaydiya, they're not the Rafida. They're not like the Rafida. They're from the Muslims. They're not outside of the fold of Islam. They don't say the stuff that the Rafida are saying. The great scholar in Islam, Al-Imam Muhammad ibn Ali al-Shawkani, was from those people. He was from those people at one time, and then he became the scholar that he became. He wrote Nadal Awtar, Sayyid al-Jarar, and all of those other books, Fathul Qadir and Tafsir, and he became a big scholar in Al-Islam. So the Zaydiya are not like them. Another issue about the Shiite Ikhwani, a long time ago, you will find scholars who are narrators in the Hadith, in the Kutub al-Sitta, in those main books, you will find some of them are Shiite. They are Shiite. But Shiite back then meant that they used to give virtues, they used to give preference to Ali, and said Ali was better than the other companions, but they didn't curse the other companions. They said that Al-Imam Abdul Razak al-San'ani was from those people, and other than him, Al-Imam al-Nasa'i, they said was from that, from them people, but that's what at-Tashayyur was back then. Then it became something else. Another thing that we didn't mention was, why do you think there's such a big similarity between the Yahud and the Rafida? Because the main hypocrite during the time of the Prophet, his name is Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Sulul. He was from the Yahud. And they saw that they cannot defeat Islam from outside because it was just too powerful. They couldn't deal with the Muslims from outside. He used to try to make every trouble to try to get the Muslims. It was impossible. So what did he do? He said, we're going to get them from inside. And they started throwing inside of the well that which was a problem. At-Tashayyur, Ahlul Bayt, this kalam, Ali, Ali, Ali. And then he started traveling around the Muslim empire, instigating, making big trouble for the people in this regard. So the Zaydiya are Muslims, inshallah. Fikum barak. Tfaddi ya ammi. Tfaddi ya sheikh. the main causes that the Muslims are finding with all of these problems that are going on all over the world, I'm not going to say is generic, but I will say that the Prophet, he explained it to us, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And although it is a musiba, the fact that he told us about it should cause our iman to increase. He says, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in an authentic hadith, إذا اتبعتم الإينة إذا تبايعتم بالإينة ورضيتم بالزرع وأخذتم بأذناب البقر وتركتم الجهاد في سبيل الله كتب الله تعالى عليكم ظلا لا ينزع عنكم حتى ترجعوا إلى دينكم. He told his companions, if you people become busy in riba, this ummah, if you start doing riba, and if you become overwhelmed and engrossed in agriculture, and if you start taking the tails of cows, meaning the dunya, and if you leave al-jihad fi sabilillah, Allah is going to put you down, and he won't let you come back up until you return to your religion. Until you return to your religion. He told the people, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, yushiku wa tatada'a and tada'a alaykum al-umam kama tada'a al-akalatu ila qas'atiha. Qalu, amin qillati nahnu yawma idhin ya Rasulullah, qala, bal antum yawma idhin kathir, walakinakum ghutha, ka ghutha is sail. All of the communities are going to come and converge on this ummah the way the diners converge on a plate. They said, will they do that because we're going to be few in number? He said, no, you're going to be many in number, over a billion people, many in number. But you'll be like weak, like the foam of the ocean. Allah will take the fear of your enemy out of their hearts, and he'll throw into your hearts al-wahn. They said, what is wahn, ya Rasulullah? He said, hubbu dunya wa karahiyatul maut. You people are going to love the dunya, and you people are going to hate death. Doesn't mean you want to die, but it means death is the focal point of the person. So he's going to curtail his behavior. He's going to pray. He's going to be a person who knows there's Yawm al-Qiyam. I can't act anyway. Death here doesn't mean he wants to throw caution to the wind and just die. Get killed or killed. Doesn't mean that. You will love the dunya, and you want to hold on to the dunya. Like the ayah, ya ayyuhalladhina amanu ma lakum idha qila lakum anfiru fi sabilillahi thaqaltum min al-ard. Oh, you believe. What's wrong with you? When it said to you, go out in the cause of Allah, you hold on to the earth, the dunya. No, go and do that ibadah. The things that you don't like to do, forgive, overlook, make peace, unite. You know those things. You have to make jihad against yourself. The things that Allah told us to do. And we do some the way we want, we do some we don't want, and so forth and so on. So that's the da and the dawa. Come back to our religion. Come back to our religion. Come back to the original religion of the aslaf. Any more questions? Ikhwani, my man, my neighbor in the hotel. Don't have a lot of time to deal with al-Ikhwan al-Muslimin. A lot of the shuyukh and tulab al-ilm, they wrote about the Ikhwan al-Muslimin from a historical perspective, from an academic perspective, and they have exposed them for their reality. How the leader al-Hasan al-Banna was a person who had Sufism, and he took the bay'ah of the Sufism. There were many dynamics that were mentioned. How Sayyid Qutb, who's one of the biggest mufakkirs, how he also said things that were not acceptable, like everything is Allah and Allah is everything. How he made bad comments against the companions. How he made bad comments against the prophets and the messengers. Mistakes that he made. But they're the type of mistakes that it shows you when you have this accumulative effect. All of these mistakes, something is wrong there. Something is wrong there. Something is wrong there. Another issue, Ikhwani Akhi, is you find with the Ikhwan Muslimin, many of the splinter groups came from the Ikhwan Muslimin. Ikhwan Muslimin is the original group. They called it the Jama'atul Umm, the mother group. From them in Egypt came the Jama'at al-Takfir wa Hijra. From them came the Hizb al-Tahrir. From them came all of this issue of this fitna with, we don't want to get into mentioning names, but some of the people who have been the biggest Muslim terrorists have been affected by the da'wah of Sayyid Qutb, that takfiri da'wah. Now again, I say, Rahimullah Sayyid Qutb, Rahimullah. One extreme is to say his shaheed is in Jannah. The other extreme is to talk about him as if he was a criminal. He was a man who was an adib. He had ghira for Islam, jealousy for Islam. He wanted to make sacrifices for Islam, but he wasn't a scholar. And as a result of that, he fell into some serious errors. If you were ikhwani, muta'athir, with that dawah, you have to be fair and just. You have to be fair and just. Awradaha sa'dun wa sa'dun mushtamil ma hakadha ya sa'dun turadul ibil. Not like that is the dawah. What you see him saying and Hasan al-Banna saying is what's going to help the Muslims. And we can say a lot, ikhwani. I don't want anybody here to think what's going on in Egypt, for an example. This is an example. The Ikhwan Muslimin, they won what appeared to be fair and square. Where's democracy? They won? Okay. Now they should be the leaders. People shouldn't step in now and kick them out. They won. So as a Muslim, Salafi Ahlul Hadith, you should pay attention and listen. When Mubarak was there, when Mubarak criminal was there, Salafi people were screaming up and down against the Ikhwan who wanted to make khuruj. Khuruj against Mubarak was not right. Salafi people saying, don't make khuruj. It's not right. He's a criminal. And I say you shouldn't make khuruj. But now he gets replaced by the Ikhwan Muslimin. People say, make khuruj. It's not fair. They're the leaders. You shouldn't make khuruj. But there's an observation. The Ikhwan, wherever they are, Jamaat al-Islami, wherever they are, they will criticize the leader, make tahyij and agitate the Shabab against the leader. But when they got in charge in Egypt, what did they do? Did they judge by what Allah revealed? They didn't judge by what Allah revealed. They did in some things. And like all of the other Muslim leaders, like everybody else, they didn't do in other things. They took a loan from the World Bank that had riba connected to it, unlike any other loan ever. They used to accuse the leaders. You take riba. First thing they did, riba. Why? Because, you know, the ones in charge, they say, hey, this is the reality on the ground. The world is against us. We have to do this. We have to do that. So just as you feel for yourself, you have excuses, a'dhar. You have to make those same excuses for the people of Saudi Arabia, for the people of Kuwait, for the people of Qatar, for the people in Algeria, for the people in... We have to be fair and we have to be balanced. That's our religion, fairness and balance. Don't anyone think that I'm for the Ikhwan Muslimin. I believe that Ikhwan Muslimin is a faulty way. It's faulty. But the justice is that they have some people who have knowledge. They have some people who are memorized of the Quran. Some of our hardcore, rough, ignorant brothers will say, oh, that's Mawazanat. I won't even get into that stuff. Give them people the time for that. Kalam. The best way to raise the kids Islamically is a big question. It's a lecture, inshallah, in and of itself. To give an answer right now, I'm going to be deficient in whatever I say because I'm absolutely sure, inshallah, there are going to be other factors and variables that should have been mentioned or could have been mentioned. But generally speaking, it requires a commitment from the parents. It requires a commitment from the parents. It can't be just wishful thinking. Allah Ta'ala mentioned in the Quran, وَقَالَتِ الْيَهُودِ وَقَالَ أَهْلِ الْكِتَابِ وَقَالَ أَهْلُ الْكِتَابِ لَنْ يَدْخُلُ الْجَنَّةِ إِلَّا مَنْ كَانَ هُودًا أَوْ نَصَارًا. The Jews and the Christians say, no one's going to go into the hell, Jannah, except a Jew or Christian.
That's it, Jew or Christian. Allah Ta'ala mentioned in the next ayah, Laysa bi amaniyihim. That is not with your wishful thinking. That's just wishful thinking. It's just wishful thinking. So you can't want Islamic education and the mother and father are not committed as examples, being on top of those kids, taking those kids, picking up those kids, wherever they're going to school, Muslim school, public school. You have to be part of the process. Homeschooling, you have to be part of the process. We have to be diligent, and it starts with the parents first. Starts with the commitment of the parent, not the child. He's the guy you're just trying to develop him. The parents have to be committed. The community of parents have to be committed. So I say the onus, the burden of success, inshallah, the effort, the lion's share is on the shoulders of the mother and the father of that child before he even looks to the community. You do what you can do with your kid. And then collectively, inshallah, ta'ala, we work together. But it is a big issue. Any more questions, Ikhwani, before I roll out of here? Inshallah. Wa alaykum salam, akhi. The brother wants to know that we mentioned that the Ahlul Kitab, they make tahrif, where they change the meaning of the books. And the Rafida, they make tahrif. And other jama'at, they also make tahrif. And the brother said there's a distinction between a ta'wil, which is giving something an interpretation, to interpret the thing like that, and tahrif, which means to change the meaning. He says, so they're two different terms. And tahrif is more severe than ta'wil. That's a very technical observation that I'm not prepared to jump into that arena of discussion, because I would like to jump into that arena with a sure footing. And when we look at these issues of the philosophical approach of these issues that the scholars came up with as a result to repel the people of ta'wil and tahrif and stuff like that, because there is a difference, no doubt about that. But is this one more general and this one is more specific and this is more severe and that? I'm not going to say all of that. Me, Abu Usama, I'm not going to say that. Changing tahrif means to change something. So if someone said that Allah's coming down means his rahmah comes down, that is not ta'wil. That is not an interpretation. That is changing the meaning of the word of the ayat. The individual who says that Allah's hand, it means his power. That is not ta'wil. That is changing the meaning of the ayat. That's changing the meaning of the ayat. So I stand on what I said, that this issue of tahrif, ta'wil, I say, let's not... What's that ibara? Split hairs. Let's not split hairs. Ahl al-Sunnah, our way with the names and attributes of Allah is that we believe in them the way they came, without any ta'wil, without any tahrif, without any ta'til. And I don't have the time, and without any tafweed, other than to make the tafweed, the true meaning of it is, Allah knows the reality of it. Now, I'm not going to sit and debate about what's the difference between ta'til and ta'rif, with ta'wil and tahrif and ta'til, and miss the boat. The boat is the companions digging into all of those questions. Let's just believe the thing the way that it came down. We're going to stop here, Ikhwani. I ask Allahu Tabarak wa Ta'ala to bring our hearts together. Please, nobody understand that I'm trying to fight people here. I know that when you start mentioning groups, sometimes it's even better. Don't mention names of people, because you may have the truth, but when you mention the name, the person gets upset. He takes it as a personal attack. If you mention his group, if you mention his sheikh, he takes that as a personal attack. But as we said, you can always present your question, and if we can deal with it, we'll do our best to deal with it. But my niyyah, my goal and objective, is not to take cheap shots. It's to say to you Muslims, especially to you youngsters, the way of the companions. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah wa barakatuh.
جزاك الله خير يا شيخ أسامة. Yes. Inshallah, we're going to